there. Thanks for joining us. This is the certification exam prep session for the 70-462 Administering Microsoft SQL Server 2012. My name is Christopher Harrison. I'm a Microsoft Certified Trainer. I am owner of Geek Trainer, and that also, interestingly enough, happens to be my Twitter handle as well. Today, I happen to be joined once again.
My name is Susan Ibach, and I'm also a Microsoft Certified Trainer. And these days, I'm working up in Microsoft Canada. And of course, being a Canadian, my Twitter handle has to be relevant. So my Twitter handle is at HockeyGeekGirl.
Which works, again, because still a geek and still a girl.
Exactly.
Very fitting. All right. So I guess with all that, that really just kind of raises the question about the fact that you know SQL Server 2012. You know how to get in, you know how to create your databases, you know how to troubleshoot. So the next question then just becomes, well, how do you go about getting certified, becoming an MCSA on Microsoft SQL Server 2012?
And that is a really good question too, because a lot of times we work with a product for a while, but we haven't necessarily really had a chance to learn how do we go from knowing about a product to actually getting certified on the product. So what we want to do is just sort of take you through a path that you can use to get from I've used the product to being certified on the product. So we've got a simple four steps I'm just going to bring up here on a slide so you can get a feeling of a nice, easy plan of attack, if you will. The first thing is to just identify your certification goal. If you're here today, well, you're already working with SQL Server, so let's look at what the certification goals would be for a SQL Server developer, programmer, administrator. Then the next thing you want to do is you don't want to restudy everything you already know. You already know the basic commands for creating a database, setting up your transaction logs, and so on. So what you want to do is figure out what you don't know and find the gaps in your knowledge. Then, once you've found the gaps, you want to spend some time filling those gaps you've got in your knowledge, and then you'll be ready to go take that exam.
Absolutely. So let's talk a little bit about item one there, figuring out, okay, well, exactly what needs to be done to become certified. And as it turns out, there's three exams to achieve the MCSA, Microsoft Certified Solutions Associate, on SQL Server 2012. You're going to notice that there's an exam on querying, 74-61. You'll notice that there's an exam on administering SQL databases. Oddly enough, that's the one we're here to talk about.
462.
462. And then finally, last but not least, 463, implementing a data warehouse with Microsoft SQL Server. So those three exams, and then you'll obtain your MCSA on SQL Server 2012.
But it doesn't matter what order you take the exams in. It's just when you've passed all three of those exams, you've earned your MCSA. But instead, in this session, we're going to focus in on that 462 exam.
Yep. In fact, when you're trying to decide what order it is that you should take them in, one of the things that I always suggest is take the one that you feel more confident with. So
absolutely,
if you spend a lot of time going in and doing the administration as opposed to querying data and doing your update, start with the one that you know. There's just something psychologically that helps if you pass that first test.
It's a good feeling, yeah. You want to start off with success.
You know, kind of the little things in life. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, if you've never taken an exam before, a couple of things that are good to be aware of when you walk in there. The exams are between 40 to 60 questions long, and you'll have 2 to 3 hours to complete that exam. Now, I have yet to meet someone who told me, if I'd only had another half hour, I would have passed. So generally, you're going to find you have enough time to take that exam. The 2 to 3 hours is probably going to be fine for you. I don't get stressed out too much about the time.
And remember, it's not a race. You don't get a higher score because you know, finished faster. You know, it's not going to give you that many bragging rights amongst your friends.
Yep.
Well, maybe you've got a couple of competitive friends. But, you know, outside of that, it's not a race. Take your time. Relax. As Susan mentioned, nobody's ever come to either one of us and said, you know, if I just would have had 15 more minutes, I would have done it. So relax. Take your time. And don't worry about how much time you actually have total for the exam.
And the other thing I'm sure you're wondering is, well, how much do I have to score to pass? So the actual passing mark on the exam is 700. So 700 or higher, you have passed the exam. And again, nobody is actually, it's interesting, you know, once you get the certification, your transcript's not going to say, woohoo, hey, look, he got 900 and I only got 700. Oh, man, well, I'm not going to, you know, she doesn't really know her stuff. No, 700 is the passing mark. As long as you get that, you've got the exam, you'll be able to get that certification. So it's not your score that's recorded. It's simply the fact that you passed that exam. So don't feel like getting 710 is an achievement. 710 rocks. 800 is amazing. But hey, either way, you've passed that exam.
Absolutely. One of the little bits of trivia for the day, 700 is not 70%.
That's right. A lot of people think it is.
Exactly. Yeah, as it turns out, each exam will have a cut score. This is the number of questions that you need to get right. That's automatically scaled to 700. They scale up and down from there, but 700 is not necessarily 70%.
Yeah. So. But that's still a passing score, though.
Absolutely.
When you get that card back, you're looking for the 700.
Exactly. If you got 750, again, you study too hard. All right.
So once you, we talked a bit about the exam and the certification goal. So you'd be going for the MCSA on SQL Server 2012 and take, starting with probably the 462 exam if you're watching this session. So our next goal is to find the gaps.
Yep. So how do we go about figuring out where we're not strong and where are we weak? And so the best thing to do is check the exam guide. Go look at that skills measure
gold.
Tab.
That,
it really is.
Yeah.
People always ask, hey, what do you use for a study guide? That's honestly it. That skills measure, because that's going to tell you what's on the test.
Yeah, and a nice thing to be aware of, sometimes people think, oh, the exam's going to ask me all sorts of weird, obscure things that I don't know. No. What would be the point of testing you on features that aren't used? That wouldn't show that you have value when you go to a manager and you accept a job. So the exam really focuses on, we think of it as the 80-80 rule. It focuses on the 80% of the features people use 80% of the time. So there's going to be a lot of stuff on the exam that you are already know and are comfortable with. So in this session, just to make you aware, we're going to focus in on maybe the stuff you don't always work with.
Exactly.
So on this particular exam, if you can actually bring up the slide where we see the exam objectives for this particular exam, you can see the different sections, and you can also see the weightings of different sections. And do take a glance at the weightings, because you might see there's one section that maybe it's only worth 10%, another that might be worth 30%. That can help you prioritize your study time.
Absolutely. In fact, we should call out on this particular slide. You'll notice down towards the very bottom there, implement high availability. You'll notice that that's 12%. You compare that with, say, implement security, 20%. So obviously, you're seeing a bit of a weighting there. So if you're weaker on one area, you know where to focus that attention. So as far as the exam goes, security, big. High availability, don't get me wrong, still very important. You still got to know it. But if we're talking about, say, a 50-question test, making the math easy again on myself, that 12% is going to be 6 questions. So you can adjust accordingly there. You take a look at, say, managed data. Again, that 50 questions, you're going to be talking about 10 questions then on managing data.
Right. And here on this slide, you can see listed the exam objective areas. So you're going to be quizzed questions on installing and configuring databases, maintaining your database instances, optimizing and troubleshooting SQL Server, managing data, implementing security, and implementing high availability. But let's be clear, if you actually go to the exam objectives on the Microsoft Learning website, you'll actually see for each of those sections a detailed list that gives you a lot more information of what's covered on those specific topics. And that is how you really find the gaps in your knowledge. You'll read through that and go, oh yeah, well, I know how to back up a database. I knew how to do a restore. But then I'm like, oh, what's transparent data encryption? I'm not familiar with that. That's how you find the gaps in knowledge, and that's how you know how to study effectively. You find those areas you don't know that are going to be on the exam if they're listed on the objectives. That's what you're going to go study.
And be brutally honest with yourself. So if you look at it and you go, you know, I could do that if, you know, my life depended on it, then in that case, it's probably something you want to go back and double check. Or if you look at it and you go, you know, if I fired up Bing and I did a real quick search on that, I could figure out how to do that, then you're not going to know it for the exam. During the exam, you're not going to have access to your book. You're not going to have access to books online.
You don't get a phone a friend.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There really should be a couple of lifelines, you know? It would make things a little bit easier.
Yeah, 50-50, phone a friend.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah. But you know what? We should get on to the part of this session that everybody's waiting for.
Yeah.
Which is, one of the things we can do in this session is maybe we can fill in a few gaps in knowledge that we suspect you may actually have, some common areas that a lot of people who just work with the product every day may not have explored.
Yeah, and hopefully kind of help focus your studying a little bit as well, kind of point out some of the areas that generally people tend to be a bit weak in, or really kind of get your attention focused on getting ready to take the exam. So rather than just simply focusing in on a specific technology, but maybe what type of a question you might expect on certain features.
Sure, yeah. We can't get you from 0 to 700, but maybe we can get you from 600 to 700.
There you go, yeah.
So let's start with the first topic area that's on the exam, which is installing and... apparently I can't talk today.
So in English, that was...
That was install and configure SQL Server 2012.
All right. So when it comes to installing and getting SQL set up, there's obviously a lot of different moving parts that we're going to have. One of the basic best practices is handling all of your data files. So our data files should be on one set of disks, our log files should be on a different set of disks, and then finally, tempdb is on a separate disk. One of the littlest things that you can do when it comes to improving performance of SQL is not only just move tempdb somewhere else, but size tempdb appropriately. Remember when it comes to planning tempdb that every time that you recycle SQL, you reboot the server, you restart the service, tempdb is destroyed and recreated. And it's recreated at that default extremely small size. And it auto-grows in extremely small chunks. So when it comes to performance, you're going to be waiting for tempdb to grow and grow and grow and grow until finally it gets to the size that it really should be. So when you're installing and setting up your environment, make sure that you size tempdb appropriately so that way you're not having to wait for it to grow. We also, of course, have to figure out where our data is going to go. We're going to talk a bit about this as we dig in, but we do have our file groups, which are going to be groups of files. That's where our data is going to be written out to. We've got partitioning, which will, of course, give us the ability to put certain portions of tables into different spots, so my old orders can go over here, my new ones can go over here. And then we've also got a couple of really cool technologies dealing with our blob data, the file stream file table.
I was going to say, things like file stream, which is, file stream was a feature that was added in 2008, and it's quite a nice feature because more and more of us are storing binary data, so that's becoming an issue more and more DBAs are having to focus on is how do I store this binary data? How do I store images? How do I store Word documents and so on? So file stream is one of those options for storing that var binary data, and then you've got the file table as well, which is actually a new feature in 2012.
It is, and it's really cool because one of the nice things about file stream is that you can go in with your stream reader for if you're a .NET person, go read that, but the problem is as Susan mentioned, just a flat store. With file table, what I can do is actually create a directory structure so it can make it a much better solution for storing those back-end files and then creating some form of .NET or other front-end for that.
And maybe this is a good time to point out that basic exam tip, which is if you are creating an exam yourself, if you want to create an exam for somebody to become certified in SQL Server 2012, you'd want to make sure that exam couldn't be passed by somebody who'd been working with SQL Server 2008 for the last, you know, 4 years, and had never even opened SQL Server 2012. That wouldn't be fair. I shouldn't be able to get certified on Server 2012 if I haven't used it. So how do I make an exam with questions such that I can make sure someone who's only used 2008 won't pass it? Well, you have to ask a lot of questions about the new features. So one of the things you do when you're trying to find those gaps in your knowledge, one of the things I always do is I always look for new features. And because I think to myself, you know what? I better know, make sure I know what the new stuff can do because there's a reason it was added.
Absolutely. You'll also want to make sure that you, of course, know how to do the installation of SQL. We've got a couple of slides coming up. One big thing that exams always like to ask are what I like to call desert island questions, where if I dropped you onto a desert island with a copy of Visual Notepad.
I'm not sure you took the same exam I did. I don't remember the desert island question, but
really?
Go on.
All right. So I dropped you onto a desert island, and all that you had at your disposal was a copy of Visual Notepad. Could you back up this database?
All right.
That's going to be your way off the desert island. And you will notice those types of questions, that they are going to have questions on syntax, and you don't get the ability to just simply hit F1 and get the help dialog to pop up. So bringing that back to the core installation, you are going to potentially be tested on switches. So yeah, you're very comfortable with the UI, but of course, if you're going to be truly administering SQL in the enterprise, automating installation of SQL is going to be very important. So make sure that you understand the command line. Make sure that you're prepared and ready for those desert island type of questions.
The other thing I find that's important, too, is a lot of times we spend most of our time inside SQL Server Management Studio, but there's a lot of other tools as well that come with SQL Server, and we need to say you know the product, you should know the different tools that come with SQL Server, not just Management Studio. So you've got things like SQLIO and SQLIOSM. You should understand what those tools are for and what they do.
Yeah. You also want to make sure that you understand the different components to install. You're going to need to be a bit familiar with SSIS, which we're going to talk about a little bit later, and then also, of course, how to install and uninstall or enable, disable certain features.
Cool. So do you want to talk a bit about a couple of the features just to sort of see if we can fill some of those gaps, maybe the core installation?
Sure. On the core installation, what you're going to notice is a handful of different feature parameters. This is basically just enabling, disabling, or installing, uninstalling those. So you'll notice SQL Engine, that's going to be the database engine. If you are going to be doing replication, it's replication, full text for semantic text. That's going to take a little bit of we're going to get to that. AS4 analysis services, IS4 integration services, RS4 reporting services. One little thing to note, of course, about those three ones, because those are three big ones. AS for analysis services, so that's going to be where I've got my data basically pre-built and ready to go for queries like I need to see all of my orders broken down by category, and I want to be able to slice and dice that based on year and based on territory. Analysis services is perfect for things like that. You've got integration services, all about moving data from one location to another. And then finally, you've got reporting services. So that way, rather than requiring my end users to fire up Management Studio and start writing the select queries on their own, what I can do is I can give them a very simple report that they can go to. So they just go to a web page, click on this, and then we can automatically open up the report, say, inside the web page, or maybe even like export that out to PDF. And that's, of course, what reporting services is all about.
And of course, one of the other things you're obviously going to have to know is basically how do you physically, you know, configure a database? How do you install and select the features you want to add or you want to remove? So you started off, you didn't know about reporting services, and then later on, you know.
How do you go back and actually add that, or how do you go back and remove it?
Yep.
And one of the ways to do that is by going in and opening up and remove programs inside of the control panel. And so you'll notice that there is basically everything there. Now, if you're going to be doing the installation and you're going to be deploying SQL and you're at all concerned about performance, when it comes to performance in SQL, it's I/O and then I/O and then I/O. It's all about input-output.
Are you suggesting here that perhaps keeping an eye on your input-output is kind of important?
I might be implying
okay.
that.
I just want to make sure I understood correctly.
Yeah.
You're a little subtle there.
I try to be. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So Microsoft provides a couple of different tools for working with I/O. The first one that you've got is SQLIOSM. Now, if you take a look at the screenshot here, I think that sort of sums up very nicely what it is that SQLIOSM is going to do. You'll notice that it's going to prompt me asking for a location name of log files, of data files, whether or not we're going to be using sparse columns, whether or not we're going to be allowing for auto shrink. You'll notice the original size. You'll notice the incrementing, whether or not we're going to allow that auto grow. And then it's basically just go. And then once you just tell it, hey, go, what you're eventually going to wind up with is a lot of great information of exactly what went on behind the scenes with your I/O. So if I'm trying to just simply test placement, that if I'm going to put a data file here, a log file here, and I want to see how that's going to work, how that's going to roll, that's where SQLIOSM comes into play. So we get a lot of great information back from that. On the flip side, if all that we want to see is just the I/O on the disk, so we went out, we purchased the SAN, and the vendor says, this is the throughput that you're going to expect, well, You know, you want to do your own testing. Don't necessarily just trust the salesperson. And that's where SQL I/O is going to come into play. That SQL I/O is all about raw reads and writes against my SAN, so that way I can make sure that I'm getting the throughput that I was promised, the throughput that I was actually sold there.
Yeah, well, everybody's conditions are always slightly different, so it's always nice to see how it's really performing on your setup.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Now, of course, the other thing that any database administrator is going to have to deal with is things like migration strategies, whether it's from development environments to test environments to production environments, or across different environments. So the other thing you should certainly know is the different options you can choose from when picking a migration strategy.
Absolutely. So one of the things that you can do, and it's one of my favorite ways of handling the upgrade process, is do a backup and a restore, because chances are, I'm going out on a limb here, you probably have a backup strategy already in place. If you don't, fix that.
And test your backup.
But yes. But anyway, assuming that you have a backup strategy in place, you're already doing the work. So I need to upgrade my 2008 database into 2012. The easiest way to do that is just to do the restore then on 2012. Voila, that's now upgraded. Another way to handle that is by doing a detach and then either copy and move the file and then reattach. The nice part about that is that it can be faster, but you are going to have downtime during that detach process.
Now, the other thing you have to think about as well is the logins.
Absolutely.
If you don't just want the data moved over, if you're going to have the same user, you also need to think about having the login set up on that new database.
Yep. Yeah. Remember that your logins, by default anyway, are going to be in master, and the users are going to point back to those logins. The users are, of course, inside of the database. So if I move the database over and I left all my logins on the prior server, I'm going to wind up running into problems.
And I get a lot of calls to that help desk.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And fortunately, you can actually do the backup restore or the detach when you're talking about not just simply upgrading from prior versions, but also if I need to migrate, like Susan mentioned before, maybe I've created everything on test and now I'm ready to go live with that. I could just restore a copy of that inside of that environment.
You mentioned most of these earlier, so we won't spend long on this particular topic, but there are said different SQL Server components you might need to set up. You've got your analysis services. As I said, you're talking for slicing, dicing large amounts of data, more data warehouse style structure.
Yep.
Reporting services, so you'd have pre-baked reports set up for your users. Full text indexing, which allows you to do those types of searches where you're storing resumes and you want to search for resumes that have experience with SQL Server. So you're searching for strings or phrases and things in large amounts of text, so that sort of capability is full text.
Yeah, so that way you can avoid saying like percent.
Yes. Yeah, there are things more powerful than just saying search where like percent SQL Server percent. So you've got your contains and free tables and so on. So how do you set up full text indexing? Because there are things you have to do to enable that. Integration services and also that file stream and that file table.
Yep. And since you brought it up, let's kind of just pivot right off of that full text search. You'll notice that there are a set of steps to go in and set that up. So you will need to add on the full text feature. If you are going to allow SQL to open up files, you will need the filter packs, the iFilters for those different files. You'll need to make sure that that you enable them, you register that on the database, and then finally create the catalog and create the index. Remember with full text search that the catalog is going to be a container for multiple indexes.
Yep. And another thing every database administrator has to know how to do is schedule jobs. We're always scheduling, you know, regular, either it's data loads at certain times, or we're scheduling our backups, cleaning up files, but we always end up with scheduled jobs. So it's really important to know your way around SQL Server Agent, whether it's just how you create a job, how do you set up the job to notify you if something's gone wrong with the job. So how do you monitor, how do you come in Monday morning and check to see if your jobs ran correctly on the weekend? So that basic navigation through the different tools, through Management Studio, how do you look up your job history on SQL Server Agent, failures, set up notifications, you can be sure that you're expected to know that.
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Hey Susan.
Yeah?
I'm going to put you on the spot here.
Oh sure, fine, that's nice.
Are you ready?
All right.
Okay, here we go. So, As it turns out, your network contains a server named Server 1 that runs Windows Server 2008 R2. They should really upgrade that.
Yeah, it should be 2012. Yeah,
really. Server 1 accesses files stored on a SAN named SAN1 using the Microsoft iSCSI initiator. Fantastic. You want to install SQL Server 2012 on Server 1 to support a web-based application that's going to be used internally by your company. The I/O requirements for the application specify the database will reach over 2,000 megabits per second. You need to determine if Server 1 and SAN 1 can handle these requirements. Which utility should you run?
So this is one of those ones where I have to remember what all the different tools do.
Yep.
Well, one of the things I look at is like, all right, so I've got, you know, SQL Server Profiler. I mean, that is a profiling tool that's using to, you know, see some of the performance. So that really isn't just measuring straight I/O. The Database Engine Tuning Advisor, that actually gives me advice on tuning the database.
Yeah, indexes.
So that doesn't fit. So, and plus, I'm just, you know, there's a little part of my brain going, I/O requirements. There's a tool called SQL I/O and a tool called SQL I/O Sim. My brain just logically says it's probably one of the ones that has I/O in the answer.
Yep.
So, and I remember you talked about with SQL I/O was that one I could use to do my testing and to test my input-output throughput. So I'm going with SQL I/O.
There you go. Now, before I show you the answer,
yeah,
let's highlight something. Plausibility. That every single answer that you're going to see has to have at some point in the lifespan of SQL Server existed.
So I can't just, it can't be an answer if it says the input output ultimate testing tool?
That is correct. That might actually be a nice tool to have. We'll have to talk to somebody about that. But in the meantime, the tool, the items actually have to exist. I actually find that extremely helpful whenever I'm trying to work my way through different PowerShell commandlets or switches or other things on the exam, is knowing that it has to exist. And that can also sometimes be a little bit helpful when you're trying to figure out which the wrong answers are.
Right.
Go with the one that actually has the name of whatever it is you're trying to do.
Sure.
Like you said, I/O. And then the other thing, just like you saw Susan do, eliminate the wrong answers.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great strategy, even if you're not 100% sure of the answer.
Yep.
My God, so I got it right.
You got it right.
Pay up.
Well done.
Okay.
I'll get back to you. I have a collection of, anyway. So, moving on.
All right. So, next topic, maintaining instances and databases.
That's, perfect segue.
That was as we practiced it.
Yes, very smooth there.
All right.
So,
why don't you jump into the content there?
All right. So, first up, we want to manage and talk about managing and configuring our databases, dealing with multiple file groups. So, the biggest reason to create multiple file groups is actually not performance, but rather maintenance and maintainability. That one of the things that SQL allows me to do is back up not just the entire database, but file groups and also individual files as well. So if I need to back up different portions of my data on different schedules, I want to split that up into different file groups. The recovery models, you've got simple, bulk logged, and full. Now this goes back to something that we were talking about before, which is, you know, we're making some assumptions that, hey, you know how to do SQL Server already, so we're going to make the assumption that you're already familiar with simple, bulk logged, and full. If you're not, make sure that you go back and reread those, because obviously that has a huge impact on how your database is going to work, the options that you're going to have when it comes time to do backup, and of course, more importantly, doing restore.
Yep.
We've got that cool new feature, contained database. We're going to talk about that again in a few minutes. Data compression. Data compression, of course, you're going to be trading off CPU for I/O. Less data, but we got to crunch it down, get it ready. Generally speaking, a good trade-off, but we've got data encryption. Then finally, TDE. That's a big one, and that one requires a few steps. And what do you say we talk a bit about what it takes to get TDE set up and ready to go?
Sure, and let me take just a second in case you haven't seen TDE before and just explain what it does. So when you use TDE, or transparent data encryption, what you're basically doing is you're encrypting the contents of a database so that if your backup file was on a disk and somebody got a hold of that disk, they can't just take that file and restore your database. That's what it does for you. So it's a very powerful capability. But what's awesome about it is if you've got developers who've built web pages that are accessing your database, enabling transparent data encryption doesn't actually affect their code. So when they're accessing the database, you know, through their websites, through their applications, they don't have to do anything different in their code, but whether or not you've got the transparent data encryption or not. So it's really designed to sort of protect your files. So if someone gets a hold of it, they can't activate or restore your database and just access your data. So it's a security feature.
Mm-hmm.
But to set it up, there are a number of steps you do have to go through. One, first you have to go create a master key. Then you have to create a certificate with the master key you created. Then you have to create a database encryption key. And then you have to turn on the encryption. Now, if you encrypt your database with TDE, remember I said if someone gets a hold of your files, they won't be able to restore it. Well, that could include you. So you might not be able to restore it unless you have all the keys to restore it as well. So when you're creating these certificates, make sure you back them up. So that if you have to go restore on another server, you're going to need that certificate you created to be able to do the restores as well. So that's really important. But those are the basic steps. So you get a master key, create the certificate with the master key, then you can create your database encryption key, back up those certificates, and then you can turn on the encryption.
Absolutely. And if I can pivot on that real quick, just kind of bring that back to the exam, one of the things about the exam is that it is going to test you on things that you don't necessarily do on a day-to-day basis. So if I've got a database and we need to encrypt it, I only need to do this once. This is not something I'm going to be going back and doing every day, or re-encrypt it and, you know, double secret probation. So if you haven't done TDE in a while, it's not a bad idea to go back and just walk through the steps one more time just to kind of refresh your memory. That having that confidence of, oh, I just did this 2 weeks ago is really going to help when you go in to take that exam. Now, beyond just simply going in and encrypting our databases, we also, of course, have the ability to configure SQL. We've got our affinity mask, memory allocation, and then, of course, our database mail. Database mail, you know, just go in and tell it, hey, this is where our SMTP server are. But that affinity mask and memory allocation, those are a couple of very big options there.
Yeah, because these days, more and more of our servers are actually, you know, multiple core.
Yep.
So one of the things you can actually set up is you can control and specify, hey, on this database, I want it to use these particular processors on my core. And that's what the affinity mask allows you to do. It's like a bitmap that specifies which of the cores you're going to let the database access. So that's a fabulous control, especially when you've got multiple databases or the server is being shared with other applications. You want to make sure SQL Server is not taking over everything. So that affinity mask allows you to control which cores are running using a bitmap.
Yep. And going back to our memory management, you can also go in and tell SQL, hey, I only want you to take up this amount of memory. That by default, SQL is just going to take everything that it possibly can. And if I'm dealing with clustering or otherwise, that might not be what I'm looking for. So I can go in and tell SQL, hey, you're only allowed up to 10 gigs. Or I can also tell SQL that you have to have as a minimum 4 gigs. So when I start SQL, it'll still start at just enough memory to get things up and running. But then as I keep querying and it keeps putting more and more data into memory, it'll get up to that 4 gig mark and then never go back down below it.
And you're talking about the clustering, so that's a good lead-in because you do need to know clustering as well.
You absolutely do. And this is one of those things that, again, not everybody does or not everybody does on a daily basis. So you might want to go back and practice that real quick before you take the exam.
Yeah, because it's an important thing to understand how you would do it if you need it. It's a fantastic failover capability. So you need to know the basics of how would you add a node to a cluster, you know, how you have to go to the new node, you run the setup, you say add node to cluster to add it. And also you need to think about when you've got the failover set up, obviously you need to know how to do recovery if one of the instances failed over. And the other thing would be, let's say, you know, you've got the two failover servers, how do you manage your instances to make sure that if you don't have a failure, that you're not wasting the server space you've got by balancing out the memory allocation you were just talking about, by balancing out the cores across the two instances, and also making sure that the server is still going to be able to perform well if there is a failover.
Yep, absolutely. We also have the ability to manage on the instance level, obviously the installation, I think we've talked enough about that, but this cool little feature called the resource governor.
Yes, love the resource governor.
Absolutely. What the resource governor will allow you to do is, depending on the application that you're coming from, depending on the server that you're coming from, you can decide that you're going to limit or maybe enhance the amount of resources that you're going to wind up getting. So if we've got some long-running reports and they need to execute on the live database, I'd much prefer to not have that, but sometimes, you know, you're just stuck with what you've got. I've got a long-running report. It's running on a live database. I just want to limit the amount of resources that it's going to have. That's exactly what I can use the resource governor for.
Yeah, exactly. It allows me to say, hey, when this command comes in, give this one a minimum amount of memory, or no, sorry, it's minimum, it's the disk.
Yeah, you
disk
can
is the one it doesn't have. It has a CPU,
yeah. Yep.
And it has the memory. So
yep.
You can set some minimum and maximum memory, and you can set minimum and maximum CPU for different sessions that are coming in and connecting to a database to basically give some things higher priority and some things lower priority.
That's exactly it.
Yep. All right, I think it's time for me to turn the tables. I think it's time for you to answer a question.
I don't think it's time for that at all.
I think so.
I know.
Did I mention you don't have a choice?
Well, I guess now you did.
Okay,
all
so
right.
Let's bring up a question here. Okay, so you have a network that contains a server named Server 1, and it runs SQL Server 2012.
Yep.
Server 1 contains a database named DB1.
Yep.
And DB1 contains sensitive information. You send a backup of DB1 to the offsite location every week, right? Good disaster recovery procedures.
Yep, yep, yep.
You need to ensure that nobody in the offsite location is able to read the contents of a DB1 in case they restore a database. What should you do? So this is a case where said, I want to make sure they cannot access that data without
okay.
my help.
So my options here for my steps, I've got create the database encryption key, create the master key, create a certificate, enable encryption, and create a credential. All right, let's see. Put on my thinking cap here. Create a credential, that is where I'm going to put a username and a password inside of SQL, and that's, that's not it. Enable encryption, that sounds like I might need to do that. Create the certificate, yeah, because we need to actually, need something to encrypt with. I need a key, yep. So database encryption key, master key, certificate, and encryption.
Okay.
All right.
Right.
So that's where we need to start. And that's actually, nice little tip there, whenever you're dealing with a build list, sometimes it's just easier to figure out, okay, what needs to be done. Go ahead and bring them over, and then let's put them in order. So you'll notice, sure enough, those are the correct steps. I'm cheating here.
Ah,
I got my little
done.
Correct steps. Wouldn't that be nice if they just automatically highlighted, hey, that's what you need. And then we need to go ahead and put them in order. And if you remember from before, it's the master key, the certificate, database encryption key, and then finally, last but not least, is to enable encryption.
That's it. So let's get into optimizing and troubleshooting, because that's a really important area. That's one of those, you know, high hit areas.
Oh.
Any good database administrator has to know the way around optimizing and troubleshooting. After you create your database, you spend the rest of your life optimizing and troubleshooting it.
And dealing with upset users.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so the first thing is to deal with concurrency issues, and one of the biggest challenges is for deadlocks. And a deadlock, of course, is I've got one person trying to go get something from table A, I've got another person trying to get something from table B, and then as part of the same transaction, they decide they're going to go to the opposite tables. Now we've got a problem.
Yeah, I'm waiting for your lock to release while you're waiting for my lock to release.
Exactly. And so one of the things that SQL will eventually decide is one or the other is going to be the deadlock victim, which is probably my favorite technical term ever. You are the deadlock victim.
You started last, you're the victim.
Yes. So with SQL, one of the things that you can do is you can get SQL to write that information out to the error log by turning on a trace flag. Remember that trace flags are going to change the behavior of SQL. And so the trace flag in question that you're looking for is 1222 to enable SQL to log those deadlocks. Otherwise, SQL's just going to go, you're the victim, and not actually store that information anywhere else.
Can I make one little tip that I get? Every now and then you do get these questions where it's like, yeah, what trace flag do you need to do? And they are important.
Yep.
But you find yourself going, how am I ever going to remember it's 1222? When I'm studying, I'll actually make myself a little crib sheet with some of those things that you just have to memorize.
Yep.
There are things you just have to memorize. You say you don't get to hit the F1 key when you take the exam.
Yep.
So what I'll do is I'll make notes on them and I'll have a little crib sheet. And obviously I'm not allowed to bring the crib sheet into the exam room with me, but I will bring it with me when I'm going to the test center so that I can just take in that last 5 minutes, a little cram into my brain. I'll just give it that one last look over and then I'll crumple it and walk into the exam room and hope I can at least remember it for the next, you know, hour and a half, 2 hours.
You can also write it down on the scratch paper as well, which is
once
another
you get inside,
nice little tip.
Once you get into the room.
Exactly, yeah. You're not allowed to bring anything in with you. Let's be clear about
except
that.
Except the brain. Yeah.
Yes. But once you walk in, you sit down, you hit start, you've got your little scratch paper that they give you, then you can go ahead and write that information down there
while you remember it.
Yep, yeah. Exactly.
Sorry, but I distracted you from the concurrency problems. Keep going there.
That's all right. So the next thing is to go in and see how SQL is doing, and that's where your DMVs or your dynamic management views come into play. And you'll notice tranlocks for transaction locks, your waiting tasks, and your execution requests. The one little thing that I want to highlight about DMVs is don't try and memorize them all. You're going to have much better things to do with your time. Again, focus in on the plausibility fact that whatever it is that you're seeing has to exist. And let that kind of help you through the question.
Read the names and think about it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
So troubleshooting data, get beyond that. We not only we have to worry about locks in term performance, we also look at things like query performance to do our optimization as well.
Yep. And we've got a few tools for handling that. We've got the SQL Profiler. Now, what's great about SQL Profiler is that SQL Profiler will basically show me everything live, what's happening now. The problem, of course, with SQL Profiler is that there's a fair amount of overhead with it. So if you're ever looking for, hey, what's going to perform the best, try and avoid SQL Profiler. Try and go to the DMVs directly. You're also going to notice Performance Monitor. And Performance Monitor is that old perfmon, the old Windows tool that's been around since like the dawn of time. First there was DOS, and then there was Performance Monitor. but anyway, with the Performance Monitor, that's going to give me not only what's going on inside of Windows, which is obviously very important, but also it's going to give me much more rolled up information about overall what's going on inside of SQL. So the number of locks, the amount of information that's currently inside of memory. We've got our extended events, which gives me the ability to have SQL basically tell me almost anything that goes on inside of SQL. And then finally, we've got the data collector. So if I'm dealing with multiple servers inside the enterprise and I want to query one centralized location, I want to move that all to one location, that's exactly what the data collector allows me to do, is it basically allows me to go to all these servers and say, hey, for all your queries, your performance information, periodically take snapshots, send that over here to this database, and then let me go in and report on it from there.
Yep.
And if you don't mind my sort of being a little bit redundant, data collector is another one of those big ones where you're going to set it up once, that you're going to set up that one database, you're going to go to all the servers, you're going to point it there, and then you're never going to do that again. So make sure when you get in for the exam, walk through that one last time, just so that way you're going to remember it.
Yeah. And, the data collection is sort of a bit about the auditing some of the data aspects.
Yep.
But we also need to think about some of the auditing we do at the server level as well.
Yeah.
And one of the features we use for that is, of course, with policy-based management.
Such a cool tool.
Yeah, it's really nicely done. Because if you think about it, there'll be things that, it might be something as simple as a naming convention you're trying to enforce across databases.
Yep.
But you're working with different groups in different cities, and you want to make sure that, we've said this in the naming policy, but are people actually following it? So what you can do is you can use policy-based management to sort of go in and say, here's what I want to go check. And then I use the policy-based management to say, okay, I want to check that, and then I can either, I've got a few options. I can sort of say, go check all the servers and report back to me on the violations of the audit. Or I can actually set it up to say, prevent it. And what the prevent does, obviously, I mean, if it's already there, but what it would do is it would prevent somebody, if I put in a naming policy saying tables must start with this prefix, and after I apply that policy, somebody tries to create a table that doesn't have the prefix, it actually won't let them execute that command. They'll get an error message back because it violates policy. So I can actually prevent people from violating policies on the servers.
It's a really nice way of dealing with that one developer who's just decided he's just going to thumb his nose at all of your naming standards. I'm going to do things my way. No, you're not.
Yeah. And obviously, like, prevent, when you use the prevent policy, or use the prevent mode, when somebody runs a command, it'll prevent them from doing it. But the other way of doing it, if you're using just more of an auditing, you just want to get reports, because maybe you haven't enforced these policies before and you just want to see what's going on, you can use an on-demand method where you just sort of go in and kick it off, or otherwise you could just go ahead and schedule it.
Yep. Yeah, the other real big thing coming along on the auditing side is the audit audit specifications. And what auditing will allow you to do is see what's going on inside of SQL. So, for example, I can go in and create a trigger to find every time that somebody's updated data. Two problems with that. Number one, I have to go in and create triggers on every single table. And two, performance-wise, that's just going to slow everything down. Oh, actually, third little issue with triggers. Triggers work for inserts, updates, and deletes, not select. So now I've got a requirement. Somebody comes to me and says, hey, I need to be able to prove who accessed what data and when, who executed selects. And that's the big thing that auditing will allow me to do. So what I can do is I can create an audit at the server level. This is where I want to write the information out to. And then I can create an audit specification, which is this is what I want to write out. So whenever somebody does a select, somebody does an insert, I can then go back and query that information later on. All right, Susan.
Yeah.
It's your turn now.
All right.
All right. You ready?
Turn around is fair play.
Okay. All right. Here we go. So, you got a question. Your network contains a server named Server 1 that runs SQL Server 2012. Server 1 contains a database named DB1. Fantastic naming policy. The database developers report that their applications handle a lot of deadlock errors. You need to identify a solution to monitor deadlock activity. Which solution should you choose? Each answer represents a complete solution. Choose all that apply.
All right. Well, if I look at the list of my choices, profiler trace, an extended event session, performance monitor data collector set, and SQL Server data collection set, the issue I'm having, if I go back to the question, it starts talking about deadlock errors. So I don't think that the tools that are going to help me with my data collection and monitoring data collection and are really going to help me a whole lot with finding deadlocks. So I'm going with SQL profiler trace and extended event session.
And as it turns out, you are absolutely right. And one little thing that's worth noting here for the exam, whenever you have a multiple choice question like that, make sure that you read that bottom part carefully, because it'll say one of a couple of different things, that it will say choose two, choose three, or choose all that apply.
I was going to say, and then the other thing it will do sometimes it's going to say choose two, each two presents part of a solution. So the two answers together gives you the right answer, or it'll tell you pick two answers, each of which on their own is a complete answer.
Yep.
If you miss that, then you find yourself reading going, but wait, it could be either one. So that's really important.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right, let's talk a little bit about managing our data, dealing with backup and restore. This is, of course, one of those where everybody's gone in, done their backups. Make sure that you're familiar with SQL Server backups.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're assuming you know your basics of how to set up your data backups and things like that. But a couple of things that, you know, might be good to review would be your point-in-time restores. You know, something weird happened at this point, so you want to restore to a point in time, just review the basic syntax of that command, and the ability to back up individual file groups, right? Because now as we're dealing with larger and larger databases, it becomes more important to have that capability of backing up an individual file group and how to restore that way.
Absolutely. And also on the restore side of things, make sure that you do know how to restore a database using transparent data encryption, moving that key over. We talked already a bit about that. And then, of course, that page level restore. So I've got a torn page, and all that I want to do is bring that back. And there's that basic series of steps of going in, doing the with no recovery, going in, finding the specific page number inside of MSDB, restoring that individual page. Again, one of those, just walk through that before you walk into the exam, so that way you're ready to rock with it.
And I'm going to make a suggestion on that one, because that brings up a point that I've noticed occasionally when I'm taking exams, is sometimes they'll ask you to do it through Management Studio. And sometimes they'll ask you, how would you do it as command line? So that's a great example. The page level restore, you know, how do you go, you know, specify to do page level restore? It's, you can do it through Management Studio with the restore options, or you can also do it command line. So at least familiarize, I'm not saying memorize the exact syntax of it, but at least make sure you're familiar with the syntax of how you do it command line as well as through the tool.
Absolutely, yeah, know that SQL. As far as your databases go, your fragmented index is going to be under physical stats. Your unused or used is going to be under usage stats. Figuring out which indexes are actually going to help you improve performance later on. You'll notice that you've got a couple that SQL will sort of suggest inside of the missing indexes. Covered indexes.
Yeah, this is a really awesome one. The include option. When you create indexes, you have that include option that allows you to add addition column. If you know, think back to your knowledge of again, now we're assuming you know the basics of a clustered index versus a non-clustered index.
Yep.
But you know, you create a non-clustered index on first name, last name, but people are always running queries that require first name, last name, and country. So you find yourself, what happens is, of course, the non-clustered index alone isn't enough to retrieve data. I keep having to go back to the clustered index because I don't have the country column stored inside my non-clustered index. But if really it's just one column that you don't have in the non-clustered index, all you could do is use that include command, create your index, include the country, and then you're basically just storing that extra column inside the non-clustered index so that when I run a query and I say select first name, last name, country from this table where first name, last name equals, the non-clustered index can cover the query. So just being aware of those strategies can really, it's a powerful performance tool.
Absolutely. Going along on the indexes side of things, we also have the concept of filtered indexes. And what filtered indexes allow us to do is to only index certain portions of our data. So if I'm looking to just index, say, active customers or in production products, I can do that with a filtered index. And the nice part about a filtered index is it's going to be less data on disk, less data for SQL to have to worry about when it uses the index, and less data for SQL to have to keep up to date as changes occur. So using a filtered index can be extremely helpful.
And it's really easy syntax-wise, too. I mean, for syntax-wise, you basically add a where clause.
Yeah, that's it.
You say create index, you know, and you just specify a where clause, and that filters it based on the where clause.
Yep. And then last but not least, we've got the column store indexes. Again, another brand new to SQL 2012 feature. You are going to notice on the slide a link to an MSDN article to go in and get a bit more on column store indexes. What column store indexes will do is they will write out a lot of pre-aggregated data for you. So if I'm doing a lot of queries where I'm saying sum, group by, having, the column store index is going to help improve the performance of those. The biggest thing about that column store index is that once you put it onto your table, that table becomes read-only. So it's great for OLAP, but if you're, you know, using it on a day-to-day basis, obviously that's not going to work. So anytime that you want to update the data, you're going to have to either play around a bit with partitions, or you're going to have to turn off the index, load the data, and then put the index back into there. Speaking of OLAP, how do we get our data into that OLAP database?
Absolutely. And this is, of course, really important. Another set, one of those things we're constantly doing is moving data set between the OLTP and the OLAP database, or just from one location to another. So you've got a few different tools you can play around with. Let's start with actually the simplest tool, bulk insert. It still has a place. I mean, bulk insert can just take a file, flat text file, read that data, boom, insert it into the table really easily. So bulk insert still got a place, but it does have limitations. It really just reads, you know, your basic CSV files, and that's all it can do. Then you've got the bulk copy BCP utility, right? That command gives you a little more flexibility, a few more different options you can play around with. You should know the basic syntax of BCP. If you haven't played with it before, honestly, go on to TechNet, read a couple of pages. That'll give you enough to just understand what the tool is, the typical sort of command line options. And of course, if you're getting into really complicated situations, like you said, populating a data warehouse, something that's OLAP, the data is going to be a completely different structure when you put it over there. So you're going to be having to manipulate the data, maybe even cleanse the data before you move it over. Then you want to be looking at integration services. Now, you know, sometimes we use integration services, we're not even necessarily aware of it. So a lot of times when you're using the tools inside Management Studio that say export data and things like that, when you're done running through the wizard, what they've actually done is created integration services packages for you that you can then take and use. So it's just good to be aware of that's integration service as well. But you could also just create your own custom SQL Server integration packages.
Yep. Now, of course, when it comes to managing a database, it's not just about making sure that we can restore our data. It's not just about I/O. It's not.
No, though it's important. It doesn't matter.
It is important. But one of the biggest things is implementing security, making sure that the users have access to their data and only to their data.
You want to end up on the front page of a newspaper quick? Screw up your security.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That can wind up being an RGE, a resume generating event.
Nice. So what we have to think is of the different levels of security that we have to worry about. Obviously, we have to think about the login level. We have to think about server roles. We also think about database security. So you have to think about server-level security as well as the database security. There are some built-in roles, both at the server level and at the database role. You should be familiar with those basic roles and the different options.
Yep.
You know, if I make someone an admin versus an owner, what sort of permissions does that grant them? Because you certainly need to keep track of that. And one thing I'm going to want you to put in your brain anytime you get any question about security is good basic security principles, the principle of least privilege. If you ever get a question that says, hey, somebody needs access to a table and you need to give it to them, and one of the options is make them the database owner, I'm guessing the answer is no, because
really?
That is not least privilege, right? It is not best practice to say, yeah, just make them owner of a database. That'll just make life easier for them. Obviously, you want to only give people the permissions they need because that protects data as much as possible. So anytime you get a question that's related to security, always in your brain, you should be thinking, hey, let's make sure we're thinking least privilege and not giving people more permissions than they need.
Yep, absolutely. And one little side note to make here, a new to Server 2012 feature is the ability to create server roles. That in the past, all the server roles that we got were just the ones that came out of the proverbial box. Now, we actually have the ability to create server roles.
Yes!
Finally.
Happy Susan. All right, I think it's time for you to do a question.
I don't think it's time for that at all.
Yeah, no, I think it is.
All right.
So let's give a question for Christopher, see how we do here.
Okay,
so you have a network that contains a server named Server 1, very original naming conventions, as usual.
Yep.
It runs SQL Server 2012, and Server 1 contains a database named DB1.
Okay.
DB1 contains several tables. There are going to be applications executing CRUD operations, create, read, update, delete, by using stored procedures. You need to be able to ensure that your users can perform the CRUD operations by using the applications available to them. Your solution must prevent users from accessing tables directly. What should you do? And the key one here is each answer here presents part of a solution. Choose all of it apply. So this is one of those ones where a couple of answers together are going to give you the solution.
Okay, so let's see. We got deny access to all tables, revoke access, grant access to all of our tables, okay, and then we've got revoke and grant access to the stored procedures. Now, one of the strategies that I'm going to apply here, which I really like on these types of questions, is I'm basically going to break this down into two halves, because if we take a look at it, that top half is tables, tables, tables. The bottom half is stored procedures. So if I'm going to try and figure this out, I know that we're going to be talking something about tables and something about stored procedures. Okay, so let's break it down into halves. So let's take a look at our tables. We've got deny, revoke, and grant. And the part that worries me is that deny access, because deny, of course, overrides allow, so I'm going to get rid of that. Grant would give them, so again, we're going to get rid of that. I'm going to go with revoke. Okay, so there's one. Let's go down to the bottom. Revoke, create access to stored procedures for all users. Grant access to all servers. I think it's going to be grant. So I'm going to go, let's see, drum roll please, with B and E. And survey says that I am correct. It would have been very embarrassing if I would have gotten it wrong.
Worked out well for you this time.
Dodged a bullet.
Okay, now one of the other topics that is on that you are required to know for the exam is the high availability. It's not one of the major topics, but you know, if you're ever going to be working in an enterprise, high availability solutions are a very, very important aspect in certain types of businesses.
Yep, absolutely. So let's talk about the options that SQL is going to bring to the table in regards to high availability. That is a fantastic table on
We are
there.
Batting a thousand. Every time we do it, there has to be one slide. We have a rule that states at some point during the presentation, there must be one slide with a mistake on it, so we can test Christopher's ability to edit PowerPoint on the fly.
Yes.
And Susan's ability to try and distract everybody from the fact that we've screwed up a PowerPoint slide and we're editing on the fly. So this is just one of those fun moments there where, are you typing? Do I need to keep going?
Yeah,
I'll start telling jokes soon, and that you really don't want us to get to that point. Though having said that, it might be worse if we got to the point where Christopher was telling jokes. Are you ready to go?
I am.
That's good.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about high availability. One of the new features with SQL Server 2012 is this little thing called Always On.
Oh, yes.
I'm such a huge fan of Always On. I think the easiest way to describe Always On is it's the best of clustering and it's the best of mirroring. So it's your peanut butter and your chocolate put together. Because just like clustering, I'm going to have a shared IP address, a shared name that everybody can point to. But unlike clustering, where I've got the one dedicated set of disks with Always On, I have my databases that are going to be mirrored between all of the servers in Always On. One primary and up to four replicas. And just like with mirroring, I can make the updates synchronous or asynchronous, so a two-phase commit, or we're going to commit it to the primary first and then worry about updating the other ones later. We also, because of the fact that it's built on top of clustering, have the ability to do an automatic failover, or we can do a manual failover and a fail back as needed. It's one of the coolest features that we've got. We also have database mirroring, which if you've been working with SQL since 2005, it's still, you know, database mirroring. And the big thing about database mirroring is that it's going to be one principle and one mirror. So the principle is going to accept all the changes. The mirror is going to be just simply there in case of a failover. Now, if we take a look at a real quick comparison of database mirroring and Always On, what you're going to notice is that database mirroring is one database, Always On is a group of databases. The replicas is the big, one of the big things here, one replica for mirroring up to four with Always On. And you know, when we're talking about mirroring, that replica doesn't do me any good. There's nothing that I can do with it. With my Always On, I can say that it can be read-only for reports or that it's going to be there for backups. I can do synchronous and asynchronous as needed for Always On or on a database-by-database basis. And then again, with a client connection, with database mirroring, because it's two separate servers, I need that failover partner to tell it which one the mirror is. With Always On, because we've got that shared name, that shared IP address, everybody just needs to know that. Now, I think it's time to put Susan on the spot here.
All right, you get one last chance. Try and start me.
All right, here we go. Your network contains two servers named Server 1 and Server 2. Server 1 and Server 2 run SQL Server 2012 and have access to a SAN named SAN 1. SAN 1 stores all SQL data and log files used by Server 1 and Server 2. Server 1 contains a database named DB1. DB1 is a heavily used database. Users report that when running reports on DB1, regular CRUD operations run slower. They're also concerned that if the server crashes, DB1 will become unavailable. You need to recommend a solution that can maintain DB1 availability automatically in case Server 1 crashes. Your solution must provide a read-only copy of DB1 for reporting services. What should you recommend?
All right. Well, transactional replication and log shipping will work, but there's delays in some of those options. Failover cluster, I'd like the other one says I want actually to have the read-only copy of DB1 for reporting services. So I'm going to go with that awesome feature you were just talking about and go with the always-on availability group.
Well, will you look at that? That happens to be the right answer. Well done.
Sweet.
All right. You get the gold star for the day.
Oh, I'm happy now. All right. So that sort of covers off all the basic sections that you have to do an exam. So let's just take one more sort of review of the steps, you know, that we sort of filled some of those gaps. So we've identified the certification goal. You have, we know you'd be going for the MCSA SQL Server 2012. Probably want to start with the 7462 exam, which is the one we've just been talking about some of the topics for. The next step you need to do is you need to go look at the exam objectives on the Microsoft Learning website and read through what's going to be covered in each different exam section to find the gaps in your personal knowledge. Hopefully, we've helped you fill a few gaps here today, but in addition to that, I'm sure there's a few areas you're going to need to go off and read up on a little bit, read some MSDN articles, TechNet articles, play around with it inside the tool to fill those additional gaps, then you're ready to go take and rock that exam.
Yep. And speaking of the exam, let's help get you, you know, that last little bit kind of ready to get in and rock that exam. Before the exam, set a date. If you're anything like me, and I know I am, if I just simply say, yeah, you know what, I'm going to take this 3 months from now, I'm never going to get around to it. Set a specific date. So I'm going to go out and I'm going to take this on March 14th.
Yeah. And the other thing I can promise you is you're never going to walk in going, I know I am going to pass this exam. So you do have to set yourself a date and go, I think I can pass this exam. There comes a point, you just have to go take it.
Yeah.
And,
give it
a shot. Give it a shot, exactly. So don't feel like you have to walk in there feeling like you know absolutely everything completely inside and out. Do your studying, pick that date, and stick to it.
Yep.
Yeah, go on.
Set yourself some small goals, because again, if I set some far off time and I want to get to know everything by then, what's going to wind up happening is I'm just going to keep putting it off, and then I'm going to be cramming for that last week before the exam. Make sure that you set some smaller goals. So maybe if you haven't worked with TDE, then what I can do is I can say, all right, well, by the end of next week, I want to know how to do TDE, and that's going to help get me better prepared because now I've got smaller goals.
Yeah. And another really simple thing is just get a good night's sleep the night before. You know, you've been studying, you've been preparing. If you stay up till 3 in the morning studying and you're tired when you take the exam, that's probably going to hurt you more than just putting the books away at 9 o'clock, relaxing a bit, and getting a good night's sleep.
Absolutely. During the exam itself, don't panic. Let's quote the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy here. Don't panic.
So true.
Nobody's going to beat you with a stick. There's going to be things where you don't necessarily know what the right answer is. It's okay. Breathe deep.
Keep going. Always finish the exam. No matter how, even if you read the first 5 questions and you're like, oh my gosh, I didn't know any of the first 5. I was just guessing. Keep going. You know what? You may know the next 35.
So exactly.
Do keep an eye on the time. As we mentioned, I've never met anybody who actually said, you know, if only I'd had 20 more minutes, I would have passed. But, you know, maybe take a glance at the time after you've done 10 or 20 questions just to see how you're doing for it. But I said, don't obsess with the clock. Just take a glance at it. But having said that, the other thing is if you're on a question and you really don't know the answer, don't spend 10 minutes on one question.
Nope.
Skip that when you can actually mark it for reviews. So you can come back to it. Go on to the other questions and then come back to it when you're near the end.
Yep, exactly. We've talked already about eliminating wrong answers, and last but not least is when in doubt, guess.
It's true.
Here's the thing. If you get the question right, you get a point. If you get it wrong, you get 0 points. If you leave it blank, you get 0 points. So if I put on an answer, one of two things can happen, something good or something bad. If I don't put on an answer, something bad happens guaranteed. I put on an answer. The worst thing that's going to happen is just get it wrong, but it's not going to impact
your score
negatively.
Not like you're penalized for having a wrong answer.
Exactly.
So honestly, 1 in 4 chance potentially on some of these. So absolutely, when in doubt, you might as well guess. You never know. It might make the difference between a 680 and a 700.
There you go.
So let's finish off with a few resources you can use to help you fill those gaps and to help you prepare for that exam. One, you'll need to go register at prometric.com to take the exam. To help you prepare, there's a few different options. You can actually take a course. There is an initial course, the 10775. It's actually an Administering SQL Server 2012 course. Have you never know? Might see one of us standing in front of the classroom.
Anything is possible.
Then there is, of course, absolutely go look at the exam objectives. The link is right there on the slide.
Yep.
Go to the Microsoft Learning website. Review those exam objectives. It's like a bullet point list of what you need to study. And there is actually a training kit you can purchase. That's actually a book that's published, which helps you to prepare for the exam. It actually covers a lot of those topics.
Yep, it really does.
And I think that's it.
I think that is it. So thanks a lot. Good luck. And go schedule that test. Give it a shot.
Go take it. Rock it.